Yeah, I welcome you back to the presentation on analysis of determinate structures. We have been discussing numerical examples connected with finding the ILD or plotting the ILD or axial force in members of determinate truss due to rolling loads. In the last class, we had started this numerical problem wherein we had determined the axial or influence line diagram for one of the three members in which we are supposed to determine the ILD. So the problem that we have considered here is where the upper joint and lower joint are not one below the other. The earlier example that we had considered was where the two joints, that is the joints in the upper chord and the joints in the lower chord, were one below each other. Now let us try to consider the next member that we are trying to determine. That is the next member we are trying to talk about is member ED. The first thing that we do is you need to understand that we are trying to plot the influence line diagram using method of sections. So the section that you are supposed to take should cut the member that we are interested. So here ED is the member in which we are trying to determine the forces through influence line diagram, and hence you are supposed to take a section XX, and the section is cutting through three members. And please understand that the three members that we are trying to cut you are not supposed to cut more than three members here. Now to plot the influence line diagram, please understand that we are trying to consider three cases here. The first case is where the influence line diagram is between A and C. If you cut the section, the panel is given to cut at the bottom chord C and D. So please understand, I'm trying to divide this bottom chord into three parts. The first one is AC, the next one is CD, and the last one is DB. So first let me assume that the unit load that is moving on the bottom chord of the truss is between A and C. That would be case one. Now coming to case two, I've moved the unit load further on where it is lying between D and B. So my analysis next would be concentrating on the position of unit load between D and B. And the last one would be where the influence line diagram is in the cut portion, that is C and D. Now let us take the first case, that is I am just trying to physically cut the truss into two parts. So this is how you see the truss when it is cut. Now my next part is trying to take case one. So in case one, that is I am just trying to position the UDL, a unit load appropriately. So once I cut the truss, please understand the internal forces get exposed. So here if you just try to check, the internal forces are exposed at the left portion as well as the right portion. So these are the internal forces that you are trying to see here, where the members get cut. Now under case one, as I mentioned, the unit load will be between A and C, right? So please understand right now, when I say it is between A and C, it is in the left portion of the cut truss. I've cut the truss physically, so in the left portion the unit load is present. So I conveniently consider the free body diagram of the right portion of the truss, hence I'll be missing the unit load present in the left portion, and I'll be considering the right portion, and I'll be applying the equilibrium equations for this free body. Correct? So hence I consider the right portion of the truss. Now I apply the equilibrium equation. I'm going to use a very convenient equation here. Sum of algebraic sum of all forces acting in y direction equal to 0. So please understand, my objective is to get the force in member ED. That is the only inclined force. Hence this equilibrium equation is very convenient in this case. So the angle is 360 degrees, that is given. So once I apply this equation, please understand I have reaction at the support B. So I have plus VB plus F suffix CD sine of 60 degrees equal to 0. These are the only two terms that get into the equation. If you rearrange, you get force in member ED equal to minus 1.2 155 times BB. So it is a compressive force because it is minus. The direction shown is not correct, it is opposite, is what you need to understand. Now this force is expressed in terms of vertical reaction VB. Hence we will be writing the influence line diagram for VB. So this is how the influence diagram looks like. It has a maximum ordinate 1 at B, 0 ordinate at A. Okay, it's a right angle triangle. Now we have said that let the unit load lie between A and C. So we need to find the ordinates at these two points. Ordinate at A is already there, it is 0. Ordinate at C can be determined. You can use interpolation, that is at 16 meters it is 1, at 4 meters it is 0.25. So this information of 0 and 0.25 will be now used to construct the influence line diagram for member, okay, ED, this is not EF, ED, okay, in portion AC. So let's try to understand here. So the expression that we got is F suffix CD equal to minus 1.155 times VB. Okay, the boundary conditions are, okay, it lies between A and C. Okay, when the unit load is at A, the vertical reaction VB equal to 0, we saw from the previous influence line diagram. I am substituting this VB in this expression, so the value of F suffix CD equal to 0. Okay, now I'll apply the next boundary condition, that is at C. So when the unit load is at C, the value of VB is 0.25, the ordinate that we calculated in the previous diagram is 0.25. I substitute 0.25 in this expression and I get the value as minus 0.29 kN. Minus indicates it is compression. Please understand, I've got two values of the force, okay, in member ED, okay, when the unit load is at A and unit load is at C. The variation of influence line between A and C is always linear because we are considering a determinate structure. Okay, now let us try to move the unit load, okay, further on. I am positioning the ODL between D and B. My case 1 was, okay, when the unit load is between A and C. Now I have calculated the ordinates of ILD in portion AC. Now I have to just try to calculate the ordinate, okay, when the unit load is between D and B. Okay, so we just try to look here. The unit load is position, okay, in the right portion, that is DB. So as we have discussed earlier, we'll be trying to take the free body diagram of the left portion because in the left portion we don't have the unit load. So it is much convenient for us to apply the equilibrium equation. Okay, so we just try to take the left portion, free body diagram of the left portion. Okay, this is how it looks like, the left portion. So these forces are nothing but the axial forces in the members where we have cut the truss into two parts, physically cut. You also have to notice that there is a reaction VA at support A. Okay, so we have four forces acting on this portion of the cut truss. Now again I am trying to apply a simple equilibrium equation because I need to find an expression for F suffix CD. This is the force I am trying to calculate. So I apply sigma Fy equal to 0, algebraic summation of all forces acting in y direction equal to 0, assuming upward forces to be positive. Please understand, all the forces that we have marked in the members are away from the cut section, which indicates it is tensile in nature. So plus VA minus F suffix ED sin 60 equal to 0. Okay, the inclination of this member is 60 degrees, it's equilateral triangles. So the value of F suffix CD equal to 1.155 times VA, the plus sign indicates it is tensile. Right now, the force in member ED is expressed in terms of reaction VA. So please understand, in case 2, okay, the load lies between D and B. Okay, now let us try to plot the influence line diagram for vertical reaction at A. And let us try to calculate the ordinates in ILD, okay, when the unit load is at D and when the unit load is at B. So when the unit load is at D, that is exactly at the midpoint, the ordinate is 0.5 because at 16 meters it is 1, at 8 meters it is 0.5. The ordinate at B is 0. So we now use these two values, okay, right, when we try to calculate the values of influence line diagram ordinates, okay, at the boundary, that is D and B. So right now we have derived an expression for F suffix ED, which is nothing but plus 1.15 times VA. Okay, right now the unit load is varying from D to B. So when the unit load is at D, the vertical reaction is 0.5. Hence, substituting 0.5 in this expression, the force in member ED would be 0.58 kilonewtons tensile. Now when you just try to go to the other end, okay, that is next one, next boundary, that is at B. So when the unit load is at B, the vertical reaction at A is 0. We substitute this in expression 1, the value of F suffix CD equal to 0. So again the variation of influence line diagram, okay, from D to B of value 0.58 to 0 is linear. Why? Because this is a determinate truss. Okay. Now having understood how the influence line diagram will vary when the unit load is between A and C, and how the influence line diagram in member ED will vary, okay, when the unit load is between D and B, we come to the last case. The last case is when the unit load is in this cut portion, that is C and D. We always understand that the variation of influence line diagram between C and D for member ED varies linearly from the numerical value that we have calculated at C, okay, when the unit load was assumed to lie between A and C, to the value of 0.58, okay, at this point, which we had obtained when we had assumed the unit load, okay, varies when lies between D and B. So we basically try to join these two ordinates calculated at C and D by a straight line, and that completes the influence line diagram for member ED. So first you have to draw a baseline, okay, then at point C you have to plot an ordinate of minus 0.29. You have to join this and this by a straight line. Similarly, okay, when you have calculated what is the ordinate at D, which is plus 0.58, the ordinate at B is 0, you have joined this by a straight line. Now we are trying to join these two ordinates by one more straight line. That's how we get the influence line diagram for, okay, in portion CD, okay, for member ED. Now having got the influence line diagram, okay, that is for force in member ED, okay, please understand it has two portions, a negative portion and a positive portion. So please understand that, okay, whenever the load acts, okay, from O to this intersection, which is calculated as 1.33 meters from C or 2.67 meters from D, okay, please understand, okay, so that means to the right, okay, of C at a distance of 1.33, as long as the load is here, okay, the member ED will experience compressive force, okay. However, when the load is between this point, that is 2.67 meters to the left of D and up to B, okay, the member experiences, okay, tensile force in member ED. So I would like to calculate what is the maximum compressive force member ED will experience when a UDL longer than the span moves on the truss. Okay, so obviously this is a through type of bridge, and you expect the live load to move, or moving load to move on the bottom card. So I conveniently place the UDL, okay, such that it covers the entire negative portion, that is the right from A to C and again beyond C, for a distance of 1.33 meters, such that it covers this entire negative portion. Once it covers the entire negative portion, please understand, I'll be considering the area of this hatched portion because the load is present, okay, up to that point. Okay, so we can easily calculate the force, okay, in member ED for this position of load, which gives you the maximum compressive force. How do we get this? Magnitude of force multiplied by the area in ILD. Okay, how do we get the area in ILD? It is half base height, it is a triangle. The base is 4 plus 1.33, that is 5.33. The ordinate is minus 0.29. Okay, so it's a triangle, half base height. So you can see this calculation. So 30 is the intensity of UDL multiplied by 0.5. Okay, is the half, base is 5.33. Ordinate is minus 2.29, you multiply, you get the force as 23.19 kN. Please understand, when the load moves on the bottom part of the truss, of the maximum compressive force which the member ED experiences is 23.919 kN. It is compressive. Okay, please understand, for any other position, the value of compressive force will be less than this, or it could be also zero. Okay, so please understand this, how you calculate the maximum compressive force in member ED. If you look at the influence line diagram, it also has a positive portion. That means, okay, for some position of load, Okay, the member ED will also experience tensile force. So how do we get the maximum tensile force? We would like to place the load such that it covers the entire positive portion. So we just try to check this is how I would like to place the UDL. I'll be starting the UDL right from this point, which is 2.67 meters to the left of B, and then continue to the right beyond even point B. So please understand, this is something like the tail of the UDL. Okay, the UDL considered is more than 16 meters, the span of the truss. Okay, so there would be a tail portion of the UDL. So when it starts to move, as soon as the tail sits right at this particular point, you can understand that the entire portion of the ILD would be covered. Okay, for if you just try to move it to the left, okay, some portion of the negative portion will also be covered, and we have to take the algebraic summation of plus and minus. Hence the plus value will decrease. So you have to place it properly. So this is how you have to place the load properly. Now once you have placed the load properly, we try to multiply the intensity by the area, which is nothing but half base height. So base in this case is 8 plus 2.67, that is 10.67. Okay, height of the triangle is 0.58. So this is what we try to calculate. This is how we try to calculate the value. So it is half is 0.5. Base is 10.67, ordinate is plus 0.58, intensity is 30, you multiply, you get the value of 92.83 kN. So please understand, when the UDL moves on the truss, the member ED will experience both compression and tension, obviously at different times. Is it already different positions of the load? Okay, so for some discussed position, you have understood that the member experiences maximum tensile force, and for some position of load, the member experiences maximum compressive load. Okay, so having calculated both maximum tensile and compressive load, so we can try to design the member such that it takes those respective loads. Now let us try to go to the last member, okay, of this particular truss, that is nothing but member CD. Now here we need to understand that member CD is a horizontal member, okay, and please understand the load right now acts directly on this particular member. In the previous class we had even talked about member EF. So when you just talk about member EF, it is also a horizontal member, but member EF does not carry the load directly. So however, member CD is carrying the load directly, and we are talking about a truss where, okay, the top joint and the bottom joint are not in the same plane. Okay, so whenever we have such a situation, please understand, especially for this truss, we need to talk about some modification of ILD, which I'll try to tell you. Okay, so once we construct the influence line diagram. So the first thing is, we'll be trying to work this problem using method of section. So I'm just trying to physically cut the truss such that the desired member CD gets cut. So this is how you have to take the section. Okay, and again, when you see that, when you cut the section, the cutting plane should not cut more than three members with unknown forces. Okay, now having cut the section, so I'm just trying to physically separate the two trusses, okay, just like this. Okay, so they have, I've just tried to make it in two parts. Now I'll write the internal force, okay, that gets exposed, okay, or released, okay, in the three members, okay, when I just try to cut the section. So please understand, this is how the members get, the internal forces get released in the three members, in the left portion of the truss as well as the right portion of the truss. Now please understand, my objective is to plot the influence line diagram for a force in member CD, that is the bottom chord. So you need to understand, okay, that first thing is, I'll be either considering the left portion of the truss for analysis or the right portion of the truss for analysis. Okay, and further, whatever portion I will be considering, I'll be trying to take the moment of the forces either about point T or point C, if I'm trying to take towards left side, or if I will be trying to take moment with respect to point F or point D, if I'm trying to consider the right portion. So now you have to make a judgment as to which is the one, which portion I have to consider, and which, about which point I would be considering the moment. Now please understand, it will be more convenient, okay, to consider the left portion of the truss in this particular case, basically because, okay, if I try to take the right portion, if I apply moment about point D, point F, please understand that that moment will consider, will have both terms FCD and FED, that is not correct. And if I try to take about point D, I will not have the term FCD at all, so the right side is ruled out. So I have to obviously take towards the left portion, and I have a choice here, either about C or E. If I try to take about point C moment, so FCD term will not be there. However, if I try to take about point E, okay, moment due to these two forces will vanish, and you will have moment only due to FCD, and that is what we want. So you can just try to reason out and then decide which portion I should consider and about which point I have to take the moment. Hence, I will be trying to take the free body diagram of the left portion of the truss, and further, as I mentioned, I will be trying to take the moment about point E and not point C. So please understand, here to get the ILD for force in member CD, I will be trying to equate the moment in the truss, okay, about point E to the moment of the internal forces, okay, about the same point. Okay, so this is how I try to talk about. Okay, so I would be trying to equate the moment due to external forces, which includes the vertical reaction and unit load here, okay, with the moment due to internal forces about the same point. Okay, so let me just try to say, so the moment about external load is ME. We just write ME here. Okay, we are not trying to calculate any information here. We try to say bending moment at E, okay, due to external forces is equal to moment due to these three internal forces about the same point. Now please understand, I have cut the truss, and please understand, to the right side of the cut section the forces are present. When you are trying to take the forces to the right of the section, the sign convention is, okay, if it is right side, that is if it is anti-clockwise, it is positive. So please understand, okay, there will be no moments due to F suffix CF and F suffix CD, but however there will be moment of FCD about point E, okay, and that is anti-clockwise, hence it is positive. The moment is F suffix CD into 3.464. So this is how I get M suffix equal to plus F suffix CD into 3.464. I rearrange, I get F suffix CD, so as plus ME by 3.464. So that is a relation between force in member and moment at E. Now what I do is I just try to convert, okay, ME to ILD of ME, and I will be getting ILD of F suffix CD. So it's quite simple. I'm going to just consider, okay, influence line diagram for ME. From that I can try to get the influence line diagram of FCD. But understand that I have to divide all the ordinates, okay, by 3.464, which is nothing but the height of the truss that came into the calculation, okay, when you took the moment of FCD with respect to E. So in the denominator normally we will have height of the truss. Okay, so let us try to now plot the influence line diagram for moment at E, and this is how it looks like. Okay, so since you are trying to consider moment at E, so please understand the distance, okay, of point E, okay, from the left section is nothing but, okay, 6 meters, and the distance, okay, of the same point from B is 10 meters. Right, so once I know the distances, this is nothing but small a and that is nothing but small b. Okay, so we try to calculate the ordinate, okay, at the at point E by the expression AB by L, which happens to be 3.75. okay, now we have to do one extra step in this particular case, that is, this has to be modified. Okay, the influence line diagram for bending moment at E should be modified, since the joints in the top chord and bottom chord are not in the same line or one below the other, okay, and the load is moving directly on member CD. We did not make this modification for member EF, okay, which we considered in the first step, because, okay, load was not passing on member EF. However, in this case load is directly moving on, okay, that is member CD. So what, how do we modify this? So we construct the ordinates, okay, at C and D here, that is at the two joints in the lower panel. Okay, we are trying to find the ILD for CD, that is why we try to do this. So you can try to get these ordinates by similar triangles, it is 2.5 and 3. Having got the two ordinates, I just join these two ordinates by a straight line like this, and I'll be ignoring the ILD above this portion. So I'll be just trying to cut off, okay, the portion of ILD, okay, over this inclined line. That is, you can clearly see this hatched portion or shaded portion will now be removed, okay, and this is how you modify the influence line diagram. How did you get this? this portion. Okay, it's quite simple. So first I constructed the influence gland diagram, okay, for ME, okay, using this A and B. Once I get this ordinate, I further constructed the ordinates at C and D. I joined these two ordinates by a straight line, okay, and I'm just trying to remove the small triangular portion above the inclined line. Okay, I'm just trying to look at this. So this is your ILD for Benigmentity. This is the modified influence gland diagram for Benigmentity. So this is what you need to carefully do in the such kind of problems where the top joints and bottom joints are not in the same line, and further you are talking about a horizontal member, and this horizontal member is subject to loads directly. So in this situation you need to modify the influence gland diagram. Okay, now further, having got the modified influence gland diagram, okay, for Benigmentity, I further divide all the ordinates by 3.464, okay, to get the influence line diagram for axial force, okay, at CD. Okay, so you need to understand that, okay. So we have to now place the load appropriately, okay, over the entire portion, such that, okay, the influence line diagram, okay, spreads over the influence, the entire influence line diagram, okay. So this is how I place my UDL covering the entire influence gland diagram. Now I just try to multiply the intensity of load by the area, okay, and then I try to get the value of the tensile force in maximum tensile force in member CD. So this portion can be divided into three parts: a triangle, a trapezium, and a triangle. Correct? So how do we calculate the area? How do we get the ordinate? It's nothing but how to get the maximum force, intensity multiplied by the area. So intensity is 30, area is half base height, is what we get, half base height, okay, and we have got two triangles and one trapezium. So we are trying to get this as half base height and half into average of the ordinates, into distance between the ordinates for trapezium and average of the triangle, half base height. So the sum of this will give you the maximum axial force in member CD. So that is 242.28 kN tensile force. So this is how we try to determine the axial force, okay, in member CD. So with this we have come to the end of this particular problem. So let us try to take some small revision with respect to this, especially the modification that we were trying to consider. The influence line diagram of horizontal members in pin jointed plane truss subjected to moving loads directly should be modified when the joints in the lower cords, okay, are not below the upper cords. And further, the modification of influence line diagram for horizontal members is not required when the joints in the lower cord are not below the joints in the upper cord. This we saw in the first problem. And even if you try to make a modification in this case, okay, it will not change. This is what we need to understand. Now let us go to one more example. Okay, so this is a good example again, one more example. And what we are trying to take is a deck type bridge. So that means the load is moving on the top cord, is what we are trying to consider here. And even here I would like to take three members here, okay, and then determine the axial forces. So please understand, when you are trying to consider the influence gland diagram for the vertical member and inclined member, okay, we always try to link this with the ILD for reactions. However, when you are trying to calculate the influence gland diagram for horizontal members, you will be trying to link that to influence gland diagram of bending moment. Okay, so let us start with the first one, that is vertical member. So I will be taking a cut section such that the cutting plane passes through the vertical member, that is DF, right? This is how I cut, and again when I cut, it is cutting through three points, okay, three sections, okay, three members, not more than three is what we are going to cut. Okay, now once we try to do this, we will be trying to consider three cases here, that is the unit load lies between A and C. So please understand, when you watch carefully, the top panel CD gets cut, so I will be leaving that panel. I'll be assuming that the unit load is between A and C initially, okay, and then between D and B, that would be case 2, okay, anywhere between D and B, and finally, okay, we assume that the unit load is between C and D. So this is how we try to discuss case 1, case 2 and case 3. Okay, now I've cut the truss physically. I've separated into two parts, okay, the left portion and the right portion. Now let us try to discuss case 1. We need to just talk about case 1. Okay, so the unit load is between A and C. So as you understand, since the load is here, I'll be trying to take the free body diagram of the right portion of the truss. So when I just try to consider the free body diagram of the right portion of the truss, I don't have the unit load. Correct? So what I now do is I just try to apply the equilibrium equation. Okay, so when I apply my equilibrium equation, I get, okay, that is minus F suffix DF and plus VB equal to 0, or the force in member, okay, that is DF is nothing but VB, which is tensile. So I've assumed that, okay, that is FDF equal to V suffix B, that is tensile. I apply the boundary conditions right now. When you just try to apply the boundary conditions, okay, so for your VB, so the boundary condition is at A and C. The unit load is between A and C. So since I have expressed the force in terms of VB, I have written the influence line diagram for VB right now. So what is the value of VB at A? It is 0. What is the value of VB at C? It is plus 0.167. I will be substituting this value, okay, in the boundary condition. That is, we know F suffix DF equal to VB. When the unit load is at A, VB equal to 0. Substituting VB in the expression, you get the FDF equal to 0. So we have determined the value of the axial force in member DF when the unit load is at A. However, when the unit load is at C, the value of vertical reaction at B is 0.167. Substituting in this expression, I get the value of F suffix DF, this is DF, is nothing but 0.167. The variation of influence line diagram from A to C is linear. Okay, now let us go to case 2. In case 2, we are assuming that the unit load is between D point and B point. Since the load is in the right portion, we are trying to take the free body diagram of the left portion of the truss. So the free body diagram of the left portion of the truss looks like this. I apply an equilibrium equation here to relate, okay, the force in member DF with vertical reaction A. So it is plus VA plus FDF equal to 0, or FDF is minus VA. Minus indicates the force experienced in member DF will be compressive when the load lies between D and B. Since this is expressed in terms of VA, I now plot the influence line diagram for VA. The influence line diagram for VA looks like a right angle triangle. It has a maximum value of 1 at A and 0 at B. Okay, the boundary condition that we had said is D to B. So hence I am trying to calculate an ordinate at D, which is 0.667. Okay, the ordinate at B, the other boundary, is 0. I make use of these two ordinates in my next slide to get the values of the force in member DF at those two extreme points, that is boundaries D and B. So when the unit load is at D, the vertical reaction that we got the ordinate as 0.667, substituting in this expression, the value of FDF is minus 0.667 compressive. So this is at D. Similarly, when I go to the other boundary, that is B, okay, the vertical reaction at A is 0, okay, hence FDF equal to 0. So the variation of ILD from D to B is always linear because it is determinate. Now let us move to case 3. In case 3, the unit load is assumed to lie between C and D. Okay, so what we are trying to tell is the variation of influence line diagram, okay, in CD varies linearly from 0.167 tensile force, okay, which was computed at C when we took when we assumed that the unit load is between A and C, to 0.667 negative, okay, at D, okay, when we assume that the unit load is lying lies between D and B. Correct? So it's a very simple exercise, that is, we assume that it varies linearly. So this is how the influence line diagram looks like, okay, for member DF, okay, the vertical member, right? So this portion is in tensile and this portion is compressive, positive ordinates, negative ordinates. We make use of this ILD to calculate the maximum tensile force and the maximum compressive force that this member will develop when an UDL longer than the span crosses the beam. We position the UDL appropriately. So here I am just trying to first place the load such that it covers the entire positive area. So please understand, this crossover of influence line diagram is 0.6 okay, from this end, left end, and 2.4 from right end. This you can easily calculate from similar triangles. So I know what is the length for which the tensile portion ordinates are positive. That would be 3 plus 0.6, that is 3.6. Correct. So I'll be now trying to calculate this area, okay, and then I'll be multiplying that with the intensity of UDL, okay, that is 50 is the intensity of UDL, half base height 0.5, 3.6 into 0.167, that would be 15.03 kN, that is the tensile force that we have here. Okay, now coming to maximum compressive force it may develop. So as usual, if you just try to see, we've got the negative portion, okay, in this region, negative portion. Correct. So I'll be placing the UDL appropriately in this portion such that it covers the entire negative portion. So I have to now take the hatched portion of this negative area, okay, this one, this area, multiplied by UDL. That will give me the maximum negative, that is compressive force that member DF will experience when this UDL moves on the bridge. So the maximum compressive force that we get here is, okay, 50 multiplied by area of that triangle, half base, that is 14.4, height is 0.667, that gives me 240.12 kilonewtons. Okay, so this is how you can easily calculate the first plot the influence line diagram for DF and then make use of it to calculate the maximum compressive force and the maximum tensile force it can experience, okay, when the load moves on the truss. Now we go to the last, the next case. That is again, we are trying to determine or plot the influence line diagram for member DG. So when you do this, please understand this is an inclined member. Okay. So when you just talk about inclined member, it is the procedure is same as vertical member. Okay. Now as usual, we cut the member. Okay. Such that the cutting plane passes through DG. Okay. Once it cuts, okay, we are trying to understand there are three members which get cut here. Okay, so we are not supposed to cut more than three members. That's the important thing that you need to observe. So we'll have three cases here. So please understand in the top panel, member D gets cut. So hence, I'll be assuming that in case one, the unit load could be anywhere between A and D. That's how I assume. In case two, I assume that the unit load could be anywhere between E and B. And in case three, assume that the unit load will be between D and E. So I just try to first take cut the truss, physically divided two parts, put the unit load, okay, on the truss. So this is what I have said, the unit load is between A and D. Since the unit load is on the left portion, I'll be taking the right portion of the truss for my analysis. So I'll be drawing the free body diagram of the right portion of the truss. So I have cut the three members, I have shown the internal forces at these three cut portions. So that's a vertical reaction here. And we need to calculate the inclination of this particular member. The width of the panel is 3 meter, the height of the panel is 4 meters. I can easily calculate the value of theta, which happens to be 53.13 degrees. I apply simple equilibrium equation, sigma Fy equal to 0. I can relate the force in member DG with force in with the vertical reaction VB. And this expression gives me force in member FD equal to minus 1.25 times VB. Please understand, this force in member FD is expressed in terms of VB. So VB means vertical reaction V. So in my next slide, you can clearly see that I'll be plotting an influence line diagram for VB. And the boundary that we are trying to talk about is A and D. I need to calculate the ordinates at A and D. So if you just try to look at this, I've plotted the influence line diagram for VB. I'll be calculating the ordinates at A and D. The ordinate at A is 0. The ordinate at D is 0.33. Okay, I make use of these two ordinates, okay, to calculate the influence line ordinates, okay, of member FD, okay, using the boundary conditions. So the relation I had obtained was F suffix FD equal to minus 1.25 times VB. So when the unit load is at A, the ordinate was 0. Substituting this, the value of force in FDF equal to 0. Now similarly, if I attempt and calculate the ordinate at D, correct? So the value of VB is 0.333. I substitute the value of VB as 0.333. Simplify, I get this as minus 0.42. So in between A and C, the variation is linear. Now let us try to take case 2. In case 2, the unit load is lying between E and B. Correct? Since the unit load is on the right portion, I'll be taking the left portion of the truss, okay, for a free body diagram. I have shown the internal forces that get released at these three cut members, okay? And I'll be trying to calculate relate the force in member DG with the vertical reaction A. So theta is the inclination of this inclined member, which is 53.13 degrees. I apply a simple equilibrium equation, sigma Fi equal to 0, okay, which gives me that force in member DG equal to plus 1.25 times the vertical reaction at A. Correct? Now, once I get this, I am trying to calculate the ordinates, that is vertical, that is I have to first plot ILD for VA and here calculate the ordinates at the boundaries, that is at point E, at point B. At point E, the ordinate is 0.5, at point B, it is 0. I will be substituting these two values, okay, in the boundary condition. So when the unit load is at E, vertical reaction is 0.5, I substitute in this expression, I have got it as plus 0.625, which means it is tensile. Now at the other boundary B, vertical reaction is A, 0, okay, I substitute and I get the value of 0. The variation of influence Glenn diagram from 0.625 to 0 at points E and B is again linear. Let us talk about case 3. In case 3, we assume that the unit load lies between D and E. So what we normally say is, the ordinate, we have already calculated an ordinate at D, we already have calculated ordinate at E. So we assume that, okay, in DE, the ordinate, the influence line diagram varies linearly from the ordinate that we have computed at D to the ordinate that we have computed at E. So this is how the influence line diagram looks like, okay. So you can easily understand that you have got again negative portion and positive portion. So that means, okay, so the member experiences both compressive force as well as tensile force. To calculate the maximum compressive force, I spread the UDL such that it covers the entire compressive area. So this crossover distance can be easily calculated by similar triangles using these two ordinates. So right now, okay, to the right of F, okay, the crossover is 1.21. So the base of this triangle is 6 plus 1.21, that is 7.21. However, for the other triangle, the base is 9 plus 1.79, that is 10.79, okay. So now let us try to take this area of the total area of the compressive portion. I multiply area in ILD, that's half base side of the triangle, and I get 75.71 kN to be the maximum compressive force member DG will develop, okay. So let us try to go to the next one, that is maximum tensile portion. Now I spread the UDL such that it covers the entire positive portion. Okay, the base area is 9 plus 1.79, 10.79. So you can clearly see that hatched portion over there, which has to be considered, and that will be multiplied by the intensity 50 to get the maximum tensile force. And the maximum tensile force I have got is 168.59 kilonewtons. So I hope you have understood how we try to calculate the, first plot the influence line diagram for an inclined member, okay, and then we try to make use of it to calculate the maximum compressive force or tensile force and compressive force. We go to the last case, that is force in horizontal member DE. Now this is a horizontal member that we are trying to have here, okay, so we again cut the member, cut into two parts, okay. Now please understand here, the truss is such that both the top joint and bottom joint are one below the other. So you don't need to modify the influence line diagram of moments. Okay, so once I cut, the internal forces get released. So this is how you can expect the forces, okay, to be positioned. So what you need to understand is, again, you have to consider which portion is better. Is it the left portion or the right portion? I want member DE, correct? So if you want member DE, the most convenient thing is I will be considering the right portion of the truss and then I will be trying to take the moment about point G. Having understood that, I just try to take this sketch like this. I will be trying to take moment about this. I equate the external moment about point G with the internal moment. So please understand, the cut section, okay, the forces are to the left of the cutting plane, and hence, okay, please understand, if it is clockwise, it is positive. If it is anti-clockwise, it will be negative, the moments. So just try to look at this. I'm equating the moment at G, due to your vertical reaction and unit load on the truss, to the moment of these three internal forces about point G. There will be no moments due to these two forces. There will be moment only due to FDE. So what is the moment due to FDE? It is force into distance, FDE into 4, but it is negative because it is causing a anti-clockwise moment. So if I rearrange this, okay, so mg equal to minus FDE by 4, the left hand side external moment, right hand side internal moment due to internal forces with a negative sign. If you rearrange, you get FDE equal to minus mg by 4, or influence line diagram of mg divided by 4 will give the influence line diagram for FDE. So first plot the influence line diagram for the truss at point G. So G means distance is A is 9 meters, B is again 9 meters, okay, total distance is 18 meters. So I just try to calculate the ordinate, the midpoint AB by L or L by 4 because it is mid span 4.5, this is how I get. Once I get this, I can convert this to the influence line diagram of force in FDE. All I do is I divide all the ordinates by 4, and here it is minus, so the nature is negative, correct? So once I get this information, I just try to place the load properly over the entire portion of the truss, because I need to cover the entire portion. Please understand, we have got only one sign here, unlike the previous two members where I have got positive as well as negative. So the entire thing is negative. The member experience only compressive force, okay, when the load moves on the structure. I spread the UDL over the entire portion. I take the entire area, hatched portion. I multiply load by area, that is 50 into half base height, okay, and that gives me the total compressive force or maximum compressive force that member DE will develop. So I guess I have given you an exhaustive information, okay, about how to analyze trusses, okay, using influence line diagram. Okay, so you can just try to take some more examples like this, and then you can try to become more familiar about how to analyze pin jointed plane truss, okay, using ILD for moving loads. So with this, we have come to the end of discussion of both module 1 and module 2. So we have finished two modules. So in the next class, there would be a presentation in module 3, which starts in module 3. And one of my co-experts, okay, will be trying to take or do the presentations on that particular module.